Meteorologist Kevin Skarupa in the Storm Watch 9 Weather Center. One of the questions we are asked most often is what would we consider this as far as a career is concerned in meteorology? Well, we have a lot of things we can talk about here and how my career has evolved over time, as well as several other meteorologists. And there's a lot of different avenues and professions for us. So obviously the here and the now. I've been doing News 9 Daybreak here at WMUR since October of 2005. It is a job where the most difficult part is the alarm clock, and then from there it gets a little bit easier once you have several cups of coffee. We are going to talk a little bit about just kind of the background and what it takes to go into this profession. I was born and raised in Connecticut and went to school at Linden State College, which is now Northern Vermont University at Linden. Went there from the early to mid 90s. Please don't do the math to date myself, but you can see several television stations along the way, including a station out in northern Iowa to start my career, as well as here at WMUR back as Kevin Joseph in 1998, and then went to West Palm Beach for 3 years and Nashville for 3 years before coming back here and again since 2005. This is the way a meteorologist's career tend to go, where you'll be in one place for a couple of years and then you'll gradually get more experience. You make all the rookie mistakes. You learn how to really forecast the weather on a daily basis that you can't really learn in college. And then as you get more comfortable and you start to become less nervous on TV and become a better forecaster, you gradually move up to larger cities or to the region of the state or the country that you want to eventually live in. Read a lot of books about weather as a kid. Watched a lot of the Weather Channel. While a lot of kids were going home and watching normal television shows, I was usually watching the Weather Channel. I made a weather station in my backyard when I was 14. Took many science classes that I could back in middle school and high school, and then started looking at colleges, realizing it could be a profession as quickly as age 15. The bottom line here is this. Eric, Haley, or Mike, anyone here in the Weather Center would probably have a very similar story to this, that it was usually one particular event when you were a kid that got you interested in weather. For me, and for a lot of adults, they can point back to the blizzard of 78. I was in southern Connecticut, and it happened on a Monday, and we were off from school for snow days Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. So all week was wondering, how in the world can something like this happen, and how could it please happen again next week? So started reading books about weather, and that's where it really all began for me. When you're a second grader and this happens and you have four consecutive snow days, it does spark the imagination, let alone the want to learn about a lot of this. So again, your career can span many different years, many different locations. This is where I tell the younger kids that light blue jacket back in 1995 was actually in fashion. The adults usually laugh at that. But again, this is kind of the way our profession goes. You have to be willing to go anywhere first, wherever that is. For me, again, it was northern Iowa. Second week that I was there, we dealt with about a dozen tornadoes in an afternoon. And the only thing I really knew about tornadoes back at that time, being from Connecticut and going to school in Vermont, was what I had read in books or saw in movies. So again, you learn really on the job. Also, back in 1997, I proposed to my wife on live television, which is easily the most nervous I've ever been on TV, including all those tornado outbreaks. Anyway, most fun part about the job are the school visits. You have to imagine, this job requires a lot of talking, tens of thousands of words a day, but you're talking to a camera in a studio. You're not seeing the little beady eyes watching you. So the school visits are a great way to go out, actually talk to the kids, examine anything about weather. It does take me back to the time when I was learning about weather as well. And again, it's a lot of fun doing those. I probably do a little over 100 a year. We also get to do a lot of public appearances. And one of the more fun things that I do every year is jump into the Atlantic Ocean for Special Olympics New Hampshire. They have a theme every year. I think I'm on my 13th year of doing this. But again, no 2 days are ever the same. So you just have a lot of fun doing that. What has changed over the course of my career is the fact that we had only one or two different computer models back when I started in 1995. But now there are 8 or 9, all running through different math equations. And they're all different. And if they're all different, they're not all going to wind up being right. This is an example here of hurricane tracks from the 1933 season. You can clearly see what's missing here is flights going out into the eastern Atlantic or satellite estimations of what tropical systems are. The bottom line of this is it's just really tough to compare generations. We always talk about the records, and this 1933 season was one of the record highest tropically named seasons for the Atlantic Basin until 2005 came along. And you can clearly see the difference here. And that's why it's just tough to really compare generations as far as we're concerned. This is a track of Hurricane Sandy, and you can see all this, what we like to call the spaghetti chart of all the different computer maps. They were all very consistent for 2 or 3 days, and then you can see how the spread just develops over time. This is another one of those things that you get used to in meteorology, is there's a need and a thirst for us to predict farther and farther away. But you have to come to the reality in meteorology that there really is a limit to our science. And we can only truly go out so far reliably. One example I give to people is the fact that we have weather balloons that give us a cross-section of the atmosphere twice a day from National Weather Service's offices across the country. But when you have a storm coming in along the west coast of the United States, when it's out over the ocean, we don't have weather balloons out there. So that storm, when it gets to the west coast of the United States, is usually about 3 days away from us. So there's only so much detail we're going to be able to give you about a winter storm 3 days away until it gets on shore and it starts to get sampled a little bit more. So there are limits to our science. This is just an example of the hurricane tracks from the 1950s. There are about a dozen here up and down the east coast. We've gone on a little bit of a run here in the last 15 years with Irene and Sandy and others, including Tammy with flooding. But this is, you know, kind of the way it works. And one thing we learn in our science is that weather is truly about certain cycles, whether it's the sun and its cycles, the ocean currents and their cycles. They kind of have indirect effects, including hurricane cycles a long time and, you know, better chances of landfalls. But again, the numbers here don't tell all the whole story. You can have a very quiet season like in the early 1990s, and you could have Hurricane Andrew come through, which makes it a busy season on its own. And just look at the hurricane tracks here from just 1944 to 1950. Look at all the tracks right across Florida. So again, tough to compare generations. Everything works in its own little cycles, and you're going to have busier times and you're going to have quieter times. These are all things that are bottom lines in our meteorology science. This map here, you can see all the different color codings. This shows you the greatest fatalities in any given state across the country. And what you're going to notice is just all the different shades of color. For us here in the Northeast, it is wind. But it could be avalanches, it could be tornadoes, it could be flooding. There's a lot of different threats across the country and, you know, different times of year as well. For us, as far as fatalities, it's wind. For us, as far as weather damage is concerned, is flooding. And it's actually not even close. More than half of our weather damage in New Hampshire from weather is due to flooding. Lightning's the one that we can predict just about anything in our business, but it's exactly where lightning strikes. So that's the one that we tell people to take it upon themselves. You know, we could issue warnings all day long, but if you hear that rumble of thunder or see the flash of lightning, there's no chance to step out of the way. It happens in a tenth of a second, and it's hotter than the surface of the sun. This, in all honesty, is the one type of weather that I'm still terrified about even to this day. You have to imagine whenever it's going on, I'm usually here in studio. So it's not like I'm usually ever outside when this is going on. So what's unique about our weather here in New England? We do get all four seasons, which allows for a lot of different kinds of weather and a lot of extremes as well. Each wind direction gives us a different air mass. There are three different guides to our season that is not El Niño and La Niña. You have to imagine the warmer and cooling of the Pacific Ocean, known as El Niño and La Niña. It really has to be strong for that to get all the way across the lower 48 and to us here in our little corner of New England. But there are three other things that also guide that. And topography, that's the real tricky one when you get to temperatures around the freezing mark and a storm is moving in. You can have areas up in elevation pick up well over a foot of snow while some of the valleys wind up with 3 or 4 inches of accumulation. And that would look like a very crazy accumulation map if we were to try to get that detailed. So that's what's usually on us in our 2.5 minutes on live TV, is to give you a lot more information than just a map is showing you or that you could find on Facebook. So in the last 15 years, it has been a laundry list. And again, over $200 million in weather damage, more than half of that from flooding. But three floods in 18 months, starting with the Alstead flood in 2005. We had a tornado that was on the ground for 50 miles. We had an ice storm, which half the state was without power at one time or another. 10 feet of snow in one season. Irene, Sandy, the October nor'easter that produced over 2 feet of snow in parts of the state just a couple of days before Halloween, and a couple of blizzards as well. Quite a run in precipitation. This is rain and melted snow from 2005 to 2010. Average for Concord, going back for records of 1870, is 37.5. And so these were 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 14th, and 24th all time, just in a six-year period. So it was a very busy time that we showed you in those last 15 years of actual data. So here's the biggie. And this is the one that emergency management here in the state of New Hampshire is always focused on, despite that entire laundry list. The hurricane of 38 knocked down one out of every three trees in New England. I'm going to give you a website. It's called historicaerials.com. Aerials is an aerial footage. You click on the viewer, and you're able to type in a street address. And you can go back to the 1950s and what aerial photos look like over address. Over a certain address. And if it's New England, what you're going to notice is the 1950s and 60s, those pictures over, let's say, your childhood home, are going to look a lot less, tree-filled. The trees will be a lot smaller, and it's all because of this. Hurricane of 38, again, tremendous wind damage. Now, we have gone 80-plus years since something like this. Part of the reason is the fact that there's a very limited window. It's only 6 weeks from late August to early October. It has to stay offshore so it keeps strength. It has to be fast moving. So by the time it gets to New Hampshire, it still has 100 mile per hour kind of natural clear cutting winds. So because we haven't seen one of these in 80 plus years, we have watched the trees grow to the length that they have. And that's why anytime we have an ice storm, a heavy snowfall, wind gusts over 40 miles an hour, we have outages. It is really difficult to keep up with every tree around every power line in the state of New Hampshire. And so this is just where we're at. You get to something like this, and if it were to happen today, there is that possibility out there that we could be without power for 4 to 6 weeks. It's not a matter of if, because it's happened before. It's a matter of when, which could be 200 years from now. And as I always tell people, I'm hoping I am long retired before that happens again. So where do we stand? Of course, the groundhog, probably right this year. Here are the three things that guide a season. And what I like to say about meteorology is it's this 500-piece puzzle out on a table. We know a lot about the pieces, sun, ocean currents, atmosphere. It's how all of those pieces come together. And how they pull and change and affect each other that we're not at yet, even though we've been using computers for 50 years to try to figure this out. I consider that the best part about meteorology is that unlike a lot of the other ologies that are out there in science, that we don't have all the answers. And we have researchers flying into hurricanes and chasing tornadoes, not because it's exciting, because we're trying to learn more. So there are three things that guide our seasons here in the Northeast that are not El Nino and La Nina. One is called the Arctic Oscillation. It's the winds over the Arctic Circle. And when they're fast, the cold air stays up there. It gets bottled up, doesn't come south. When it's weaker, cold air will seep down parts of the Northern Hemisphere. You know this on TV as when the newsroom calls it polar vortex. But it does provide us with a tremendous amount of cold air that is bottled up from Canada and northern parts of the Arctic and slides that south in our direction. Oscillation means that that pattern does weaken and strengthen over the course of a 4 or 5 month winter season. So usually it's not one or the other all the time, but usually one dominates over the other depending. The other oscillation in a similar fashion is over the northern Atlantic Ocean with the US being here. When it's really strong, high or low, it kind of creates a weather traffic jam in the atmosphere. So the jet stream that normally goes west to east gets blocked, slows down, creates a traffic jam in the atmosphere. So when a low gets to North Carolina and it wants to go back out over the ocean with the jet stream, it can't because it is blocked by this strong high or strong low over the northern Atlantic. And so that storm then has only one place to go, and that's right up the East Coast. You may remember back a couple of Marches ago, we had, was it four nor'easters in 3 weeks? That's because of what we call blocking. So those two oscillations, again, one tends to dominate more than the other on a given winter, The third and falls under research is called sudden stratospheric warming. And what the folks at MIT, they're really smart down there, have figured out is that in some Novembers into Decembers and some Marches into Aprils, for some reason, the temperatures over the Arctic warm greatly for about a month and then do this. It's basically like a hurricane going over very warm ocean water. It upwells a lot of the cooler air. Well, after a month, this happens after the warming, and then basically the weather patterns over the northern hemisphere get a lot more active for about a month. So you may remember back 3 or 4 years ago, we had a huge snowstorm on Thanksgiving. Most people, when you have that, say, oh, what kind of winter is this going to be? Well, we went through December with about 3 inches of snow. That's because this was going on. We were getting warming. We could see this developing through satellites, which we weren't able to see 30, 40, 50 years ago. So we see this developing and know that January is going to be a different month. And sure enough, January, February, March, cold and snowy. So you put all three of these things together, the Arctic Oscillation, the North Atlantic Oscillation, and sudden stratospheric warming, and regardless of what El Nino and La Nina are doing, if they're not strong, these three things really give us a good idea as to what a winter is going to do. The real snag with it is, again, limit in technology, is the fact that we can't tell you more than 4 to 6 weeks away as to how these are going to play out. So again, limits in our science. So as far as advice and suggestions, if you are a student, whether it be high school, middle school, or even an elementary school student, and weather is something that interests you, you're watching the Weather Channel, you're interested when thunderstorms are moving in, don't be afraid to learn more. Get to know everybody. Networking in our business is really important. Stay on top of the latest technology. For an older meteorologist like myself, and yes, I spiral through midlife crisis right in front of you saying that, that is one of my Achilles heel, is trying to keep up with coding and all the different research that's out there these days, as opposed to just continuing to just look at what your weekend is going to look like. Go anywhere for that experience. And again, for me, that was Northern Iowa and an internship. And always, always, always ask questions. If you have questions for me, you can email me. It's an easy email address. It is weather, the at symbol, WMUR.com. And just attention it to me if you have any questions about any of these presentations we have posted. And again, if you haven't seen the presentations we have posted, we have them all on one particular webpage. It's WMUR.com/weather-. So put the dash in there and then presentations. So that is a look at weather as a career. I feel fairly fulfilled in my career because I get to talk about weather all day. It is something I've been interested in as a kid, as a bottom line, and have been able to do that for my career to this point and enjoy it thoroughly. Again, every day is always different. It's just that darn alarm clock at all times. You can check out a lot of our other presentations on our website as well. We're happy to add more as we go along. And again, any questions, feel free to throw them at us, Haley and I, at any time. Take care.